We're gonna meet again anyway.
Lapel pin, the flag.
Yes?
Well, I guess I'm the late one, so everybody's looking at me, and Irv says that when you're late, you get 5 demerits. So I'll call a meeting to order, and we'll have the roll call, please.
Chairman Jordan?
Yep.
Counselor Chapel?
Yep.
Counselor Cogswell?
Here.
Counselor Dahlbeck?
Yep.
Counselor Linnell?
Here.
Counselor Marvin?
Here.
And Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
Would you all please rise, and we'll salute the flag, please?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. We'll move on to citizens' discussion with items not on the agenda. Oh, excuse me. Went on. I got moving too fast. Minutes of the meeting of 8:94:95 and 9:94:95. What's your wishes?
Move approval is presented, Mr. Chairman.
Second it.
Moved and seconded. Counselor Cogswell.
I'd like to amend the minutes on meeting number 9. Item at the bottom of the page, it was a 7 yes, no, a 0 no vote, but I was not present, so it should be 6, because I had left the meeting at that point. So.
That's correct. Anything else? Do you wish to amend your motion?
That's fine.
To read as corrected?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, thank you.
The second? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. Citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Anybody out there got something they'd like to say that isn't involved with the agenda? If not, we'll move on to reports and correspondence. Anybody got anything they'd like to report? Counselor Dahlbeck.
Not really a report, but I would just like to note that anybody who has read the Cape Courier is aware of the fact that I am not going to be running for re-election this coming May. I do just want to say that I've enjoyed the time I've spent on the council. I had intended when I ran initially to be here for a single term of 3 years. It's been a privilege to serve. It's been great to be a part of the town governance. It's been great to get to know and work with the town manager and the many town employees who I think we're real fortunate to have the quality that we do have. And it's been fun really working with the council. It's nice to be in a council that you don't read about missiles being thrown at every council meeting. We disagree, but we're able to disagree and be friendly, and I think that's great. My reasons for not running are very personal. I just want to have more flexibility in scheduling time, but I certainly appreciate the opportunity, and I am looking forward to the next election. As I've indicated in the Courier, I think there are some real issues to run on. And I hope some people get out front and become a part of that election. Thank you.
Thank you. We thank you for announcing so early, and also that I've enjoyed working with you. I know I don't agree with you all the time, but I still enjoy arguing with you now and then. Anybody else? Councilor Marvin.
Well, Councilor Dahlbeck has stolen most of my thunder here, but I too, it was announced in the Cape Courier, will not be completing my term, actually. I'll be getting done in June, as will Councilor Dahlbeck. My reasons are a little bit different. It's the Augusta lifestyle as your representative is quite demanding, along with my young family, and so I'll need the time to be representing you well, and as many of you probably know, I've been named to the Human Resources Committee, and it's a very, very demanding committee. We've been charged with taking 400 jobs out of the state budget, and that's going to be a tough job, so I think I'm going to be spending an awful lot of late nights in Augusta, and I'm worried that I would be not representing you as well as I could on your town council, but it truly has been a privilege, and I've enjoyed nearly every minute of it, and I've especially enjoyed getting to know all these other counselors. They've taught me an awful lot, and I think helped me to become a better representative for all of you in Augusta. I'd like to urge people to think about running for town council. It's really a lot of fun. It's hard work, but I think you don't achieve anything unless you work pretty hard along the way, and you'll find working with Mr. McGovern to be really a nice experience. He does an excellent job and is very well thought of statewide, and I very rarely go into a meeting that somebody doesn't mention to me how lucky we are to have him as our manager. So I especially would like to see somebody with some children run for this position, because right now, Counsel McLaughlin has one on her way out the door here, and I have all the rest of the children. Of course, I have a tribe, but still, it would be really nice. So if there's somebody out there who's thinking of it and has any questions or anything, I'd be more than happy to talk to them about it.
Thank you. And I would like to say for you, from you, Counsel Marvin, that I've enjoyed working with you, and I am pleased that you have announced early so people can be thinking about it, and it's, like you say, it's been an experience, and we have always got along pretty well, I guess. Anybody else? Yes, Councilor Nell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is just an announcement. Someone asked me to look into our policy on stop signs and putting stop signs at the end of private roads and whatnot, and our policy of taking a bucket of salt from the, or sand, salted sand from the pile up at the transfer station. And so I asked the town manager to see if we could schedule that for a workshop, so we'll hopefully be looking into that in the next couple of months.
Anybody else? No?
Janet Dillis.
Oh, hi.
Janet Dillis.
Me, 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 my, me, mo.
Which one?
All right.
Counsel McGough.
We were enjoying watching your head go back and forth. Last month, I think it was probably the week after our council meeting, I don't know, it was all of us, or most of us anyway, attended a dinner in Portland that was hosted by Maine Development Foundation. This was a dinner that organization sponsored for the legislators from throughout the state to tour southern Maine and get to better know the problems and opportunities that exist in southern Maine. And they very wisely split up the seating at the tables so that you were assigned seats, basically, so you did not all congregate with people whom you knew, but you get to meet some people you would not, you know, probably met before, and found it very rewarding. And I was very pleased with the turnout from this council and from our legislators, including Councilor Marvin and Senator Amaral.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
You waiting for Phyllis?
No, we're
yes,
waiting for you.
You waiting for Debbie?
No, I'm waiting for you.
Okay, thanks. Regional Waste Services, last January the 9th, I told you about the important things that were coming up, and you probably read them in the paper about the spot that we're in on the haulers and no flow control in effect at the present time. But like all emergencies that we have, if you sit down and get 31 towns pulling together, why, they seem to kind of not quite so bad when you get into them. We're able to go through the end of June. As far as we know now, we'll know better on our March the 22nd meeting, I believe it is, with no difference in the tipping fees for any of the towns or cities through this calendar year. We'd look that might not be able to do that the way it looked. Next year, we probably, just an idea of what's going to happen, we probably will take a tipping fee that will take the entire budget under its wing, because we can in no way tax commercial people. The only thing we can tax is municipal. But there's one nice side to that too, where if we push the commercial side, why, there'll be credits coming back. And we made the point at the meeting that towns like Cape Elizabeth that have a very small commercial base wouldn't have much chance to get their residential base down because there wouldn't be any credits to work towards. So we got assured by all of the powers to be at Regional Waste that there would be a schedule so that we would participate in the commercial that's done in the larger cities and be taken care of. I'm on the board. I'll make sure that we're represented when it comes time to vote. Thank you.
Thank you. Council Cogshaw.
Thank you. The council has before tonight a status report from the Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee. This was a committee that started its first meetings on September 8th, and we were charged with reformatting the present zoning ordinances, incorporating recommendations from the comprehensive plan and several other studies that have been done by the town. We have met six times. We've had a workshop with the town council, and we went on a tour around the greater Portland area looking at good examples and poor examples of clustered developments. And the planner also took out a group on the following Wednesday for those who couldn't make the Saturday trip. Market decisions consultant Evan Rickard was the one who started with this, but he has since been appointed to be director of the State Planning Office, and his partner, Mark Ahriman, is going to continue with us, and we will meet with Mark for the first time in February. And I also have one other item I wanted to bring up. In the last issue of the Cape Courier, there is a list of the budget hearings and meetings that are going to be held by both the school board and the town council. And I want to point this out to people because I've heard some very disturbing rumors. People are saying that even though no one has met on budget yet, that there is a move to cut out certain programs in town, that decisions had already been made, and all budgets are considered equally and must stand on their own, and no decisions have been made at this moment. So for all those people who are feeling pained in town because of this rumor, I apologize to you for whoever started this rumor, and rest assured it will be the usual open, fair process we've had in the past.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, Council Marvin.
A couple of weeks ago up in Augusta, Maine Municipal held a day-long workshop for us, and let's see, Councilor Linnell and Manager McGovern, Clerk Lane, Councilor Cogasol, and myself, I think that's everybody who went, and we had the opportunity to meet with other municipal officials as well as legislators for the day to talk about budgets and education and all kinds of topics of interest to all of us, and I think we all enjoyed it and learned quite a lot.
Thank you. Anybody else? I guess not. I guess that will take care of the reports and correspondence, and we'll move on to a public hearing. It's amendments to the sewer ordinance and amendments to the traffic ordinance regarding parking. And I believe you have a opening remarks.
Yeah, very briefly, then I'll introduce the town attorney. The sewer ordinance has resulted in, first, from a goal of the town council, it was either a year ago or 2 years ago, I'm not sure, in indicating a willingness to take a look again at the sewer ordinance to see if perhaps it might be revised because of some of the difficulties that were being experienced in terms of some folks being able to connect and some not. The sewer committee did spend an extensive period of time, I think six or more months, reviewing different provisions. They were assisted by the town attorney in terms of the drafting of the language, but not so much in terms of the policy. The town attorney, Thomas Leahy, is here this evening to explain the results of that effort. Subsequently, it did go before the town council's ordinance committee through in council workshop in particular. And you set it for public hearing this evening.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman and members of the town council, the ordinance amendments that are before you tonight are fairly extensive. They do not address certain things, so maybe we'll be clear on that. We have not addressed set-asides of capacity. And in addition to what you have before you, you'll have to also consider hereafter an amendment to the zoning ordinance. So when it comes time to vote on this tonight, an affirmative vote to adopt the ordinance amendments would need another vote to send to the planning board for a recommendation to amend the zoning ordinance. That is because we have now adopted certain provisions in this sewer ordinance which relate to the zoning ordinance. Basically, what we've done here is we have not started from scratch. We had an ordinance in this town that began with coming off septic systems throughout, so an ordinance requiring people to get onto the public sewer. Then in the 80s, we had ordinance amendments, provisions, if you will, that ended up requiring that the capacity be doled out in what's called fill-in growth, fill-in between the existing properties that were sewered. And today, what's presented to you for adoption are amendments that leave the fill-in growth to a degree, adopt a sewer service area, that being which is on a plan that needs to be approved with this ordinance. So instead of having some strained language that spoke of how many feet of frontage you had on the sewer line, we now have a plan. So people can go look at the plan and see if you're in a sewer service area. So the eligibility provisions have been amended, the extension provisions have been amended, and we've also proposed a new provision which calls for the grant of a special permit by the zoning board for people to be able to maintain the present, I guess, right, or what's presently actually prohibited, but in fact takes place in some homes where the rainwater, let's say on roofs, would be allowed to infiltrate the sewage system. That's now prohibited. There are some extreme examples where it's prohibitively expensive to change that. We now have a provision to allow that with a permit and with a variance, and provided that party pays the cost of processing that additional sewage. Really, it's your decision how you'd like me to proceed. I've been up here before and gone through the various provisions. It is a public hearing. If you want me to do so, I can. The draft that the you all have before you was done November 16th. It incorporated a few changes after our last workshop, and we've highlighted those changes by shading on those that you have, by underlining all the new additions from the old ordinance, and by overstriking the provisions that are proposed to be deleted. I'm here. I'm more than happy to go through them all, but I just want to make sure that's the pleasure of the council. I mean, I won't read every word, but I can skim over them. It's your decision.
Thank you. Would you? It would only take you a few minutes, kind of skim over it.
I think it'll take me about five to ten.
Go ahead.
If I'm interrupted, if I'm taking longer, I'll be glad to sit down. Then going through the sewer changes, I'm going to go by pages. On the first page, we have an amendment to refer appeals to the zoning board. No longer do we have a sewer board of appeals. They now go to the zoning board, and that relates to what's not on the agenda tonight, which is an amendment to expressly grant that zoning board authority. So in their grant of authority, we'll also have a grant to them of this authority under this ordinance. On page 2, we have a new definition for public sewer plan. That's because we have it. It's a plan that you'll adopt with this, and it'll be the law, if you will, as an approved plan to be put up here and referred to, and it will be amended from time to time if and when you ever extend the public sewer. I won't bother with the amendments, I think, that are either clarification or without any substantive changes. We have now deleted the street frontage on public sewer provision because that was the key for fill-in growth. It is no longer the key criteria now as we have a plan. Page 4 on the eligibility of existing residences. We provide that a lot owner of an existing residence, if he is within or he or she is within a sewer service area, and a connection is not prohibited by Section 1514A, such as being on a wetland or within a 100-year flood zone, or otherwise prohibited by applicable law, then that property, that lot owner may connect that existing residence to the sewer. Doesn't say has to, but that says eligible to connect. We go on to the next section, which speaks about eligibility for new residences to be constructed. And again, if you're in the sewage service area, that's the first criteria. The second one would be the same as in the prior provision for B, in other words, not violating any other law or ordinance provision. And for new residences, it says the lot owner shall pay any charges levied pursuant to section 15.111. As such, suicide charges may be amended and approved from time to time. We sometimes refer to that as availability charges. If somebody is has had the right to hook up to the public sewer and hasn't, they have to pay in at the time they do connect for a new residence. D, now that we've done existing homes and new lots, D is eligibility for multiple connections. Previously, this had basically provided if you had a small amount of street frontage, but with a large acreage out back, you could only have the number of units based upon your street frontage. That's been done away with, and this provision now says if you're in the sewage service area and you have shown to the town's engineer's satisfaction that there exists sufficient capacity in a public sewer system, then you can connect to the public sewer. We set forth the various criteria which are to be considered when determining capacity. And this would be, I anticipate, what would be utilized in connection to a subdivision in a sewage service area. That's not for extensions, that's just for eligibility for multiple connections. E is a provision relating for non-residential uses, and it allows existing or proposed structures to hook up if it's within a sewer service area and there is sufficient capacity. That has to be determined by the planning board in a site plan review process. F is a provision that which states, now that we've said which lots are eligible, this one states which ones must connect, and you must connect if you're eligible unless you're more than 150 feet away or you have a prior private septic system which includes a certification filed with the town that the private system is not malfunctioning. I can stop there. Those are the new eligibility and requirements in place of the former fill and growth provisions. If we go on to page 8, under private sewage disposal, we have a, a clarification, and I won't explain what that is, just a clarification without substance change. Next change of significance would be the sewer extension provisions. Again, it used to be included that the planning board was authorized to waive the requirement of a party connecting to the public sewer. That would be mostly where they had a subdivision. They're eligible for maybe one or a few hookups. However, it would be prohibitively expensive for the developer to bring sewer all the way into a project. That's no longer there. We now have a requirement to use the sewers if it's within the sewer service area and the cost thereof would be at the sewer, the owners who would benefit from the public sewer at their cost. So the sewer extension provision here, just simply providing the cost, will be at the on the shoulders of the owner as opposed to the town, is a new provision. We've deleted a number of provisions, and then we next get to one that has had a lot of discussion, which is at page 13, subparagraph B, providing for extensions. And provided the town council finds there is sufficient excess capacity and the proposed extension, that is from a sewer service area on the plan to a new area, if that is consistent with the town's facilities plan for public sewers, the town council may amend that plan into growth areas which are hereafter specifically approved by the town or to serve residences or non-residential uses abutting the sewer area. If there's a malfunctioning and a replacement, septic system would require a state variance. That's a simpler one. If you're right next to the public sewer on the plan, you have a system, it fails, this town council can extend to that house or houses with failed systems without looking at whether it's a growth area or anything else. The growth areas is a little more controversial in that it's, this is, I don't know what we call, I guess in some areas a lot we call it precatory language, precatory meaning that it's for guidance, but it's not maybe legally binding. It says you as a council or your future council must adopt any changes to the amendment, and this simply guides you or that council in that amendment process by saying after you find capacity, you have to find that it is in a so-called growth area shown on your comprehensive plan, but not as of tonight designated a growth area in the comprehensive plan. The subparagraph or the paragraph below those two options for extensions describes who pays. It says that if you're a budding owner with a failed septic system, you pay. If it's an extension from the existing sewer service area to a growth area, the town council decides who pays, either the council or the people to be benefited. We did not, as I said earlier, include any set-asides for any particular deserved uses, whether they're public, school, or otherwise. And we, by this language, have said that those properties along the line, the sewer line, that would run from an existing service area to a growth area are not sewered. This does not sewer them. They would not be eligible for sewer, and they would not be required to hook up to the sewer, provided the council, when it adopts an amendment, can do it at that point in time. So when you find a growth area and you approve a growth area, in that process, you could sewer that area that would be on the line that runs from the existing area to that growth area or not. It's in your discretion. I think at that point we go through all the various and sundry details of how to build sewers, which are required for anybody who is obligated to do an extension of the public sewer. And I think the next change is at page 23, subparagraph 11. This was inserted at the request of the town manager and public works director to give them to give the public works director the authority in certain cases where someone might have a private line going over private property to reach the public sewer, to require them to build an extension to the town specifications within the public way. Secondly, when one may be eligible to connect, that they would have to, they couldn't use a private line in a public way. Both are, in the converse of that, they would have to extend the public sewer to a point in the frontage, street frontage of that house. And these are aimed at situations where the town today doesn't feel it has enough authority to say to someone, yes, you can connect, but you have to extend the public sewer more than you might want to. Some might want to cross other people's private property and not in that area build a sewer to the town specifications. This would allow the superintendent to require that the sewer be built to the public sewer standards. Let's see, at page 24, this is the grant to the Zoning Board of Appeals of the authority I spoke of earlier, a special permit. If someone can come in and would want to obtain this permit to be allowed to drain stormwater and surface water or melting snow or ice from roofs. We heard some testimony that there are only a few properties that may still do this. It would be prohibitively expensive and have other dangers to abutting property and town property if they were to do it. And this gives the zoning board the authority to grant that permit, provided that party pay an annual fee, not less than the cost of treating that sewer, and also files a form in the Cumberland County Registry of Deeds, so the world is on notice that they buy that lot, they will have some extra fees associated with the sewage, so long as they keep it hooked up for the roof drains. The last provisions, well, there's a provision that grants the appeals to the Zoning Board of Appeals. That's just a matter of clarification, as I mentioned earlier. And the town had an express incorporation of the right to use the Portland Water District to assist them in billing and so forth. And at page 28, we've changed that to any third party. So we do not specify the Portland Water District, but rather any third party. And that, I believe, is it for the substantive changes. I may have missed some modest ones, but I think that covers it. I'll be glad to answer any questions. Otherwise, I think the sewer committee and others have been at this about 9 months, and I think they're ready to be acted upon in some fashion.
Good. Thank you. Appreciate it. Very good. Does anybody from the public would like to speak regards to sewer? You all understood it. Oh, got it right up here. So
just a comment. The map that would be adopted is the one that's up on the bulletin board.
Okay, if nobody has a comment as far as the public hearing goes regarding the sewer, we have another public hearing to amendments to the traffic ordinance regarding parking at Place of Field. I believe the manager has got a few words.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. This came about as a result of a letter from a citizen who lives on Shore Road expressing concern with parking, particularly during significant events at Fort Williams Park and during events at Plaisted Field, Plaisted Park as well. As a result of reviewing that letter with the key department heads who were involved, as well as sending a survey out to the neighborhood and to the Little League, recommended a proposed parking restriction, which specifically would amend the ordinance to provide that from May 1 to October 1, no vehicle shall be parked on the southwesterly side of Little John Road from Shore Road to Robin Hood Road. But this is as you're going up Little John Road, it's on the left. You could still park on the same side as the Little League field. We also currently prohibit parking on Shore Road between Fort Williams Chapel Road, which is one down from Surf Road, and Dyer Pond Road. It suggested as well that that be better signed and more strictly enforced.
Okay. Is anybody from the public now would care to have a comment one way or the other as far as the parking at Placid Park? Yes, gentleman in the back.
Yes.
Right down here to the mic, please, and state your name and address.
My name is Billy D. Dubler, and I live at 989 Shore Road. If the council would look on both sides of Shore Road, and at the entry of Cape Elizabeth, over at the Fort Williams, there's signs posted on both sides of the road that says, no parking. Now, why should we allow people to park on the side of the road when you already have signs up there that says, no parking on the side of the road? Right in front of the Little League out reception stand, there's a sign. And right in front of my house and my next door neighbor, there's a sign that says no parking on the right hand side of the road. On the Fort Williams side, there's a sign that says no parking on the side of the road. But I have seen in the last 3 years the police department of Cape Elizabeth allow people to park there on both sides of the road. I have seen people park down Little John Road on both sides of the road, that the road is just wide enough to get two cars by at normal, that when they do park on both sides of the road, it's a one-lane road. If you have an emergency, you cannot get a car down it, all the way down to the down Little John Road. I have pictures taken that at the last time that the soccer league had their event at the Little League field, due to the fact that the school up here was pretty well tore up at that time. They just started the construction up there, and the police car could only get through that street, just barely could get through Little John. So what do you do if you have a fire and you're living down Little John Road and your house burned down because there's cars parked on both sides of the road? I don't think we ought to allow any parking on Little John Road because it is a suburb, and it is not wide enough for have cars parked on each side of the road and to allow traffic to go up and down it.
Okay. Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. Rosemary Reed, One Dean Way. Since the gentleman before me spoke about safety, I think it's important to note, especially with other items on your agenda tonight, that if there was a safe pathway for an alternative way to get to Plaisted Field in Fort Williams, the parking problem would be lessened. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
Mr. Chairman, my name is John Chapman. I live at 77 Hillcrest Road, and I'm president of the Cape Elizabeth Little League. The Little League supports the proposed amendment under which parking would be permitted on one side of Little John Road, but not the other side. The reason we support it is we understand the safety hazard presented by parking on both sides. Parking on one side, however, is necessary for us at least during two events during the year, those being opening day and the postseason tournaments. Those are really the only two recurring events when our existing parking is not sufficient. We recognize that parking on two sides is a serious hazard, and we support the change to restrict it to one side, but we think it is appropriate that parking remain on the field side. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Well, if not, I'll close the public hearing related to the sewer ordinance and the traffic ordinance regarding parking. And we'll move on to item 100, to consider a proposed amendment to the sewer ordinance and take any necessary action. Yes, Councilor Cogshaw.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the changes in the sewer ordinance as proposed, the sewer service area map plan as proposed, and that we refer to the planning board the changes in the zoning ordinance under section 1947, new numbered sub B.
Second.
Thank you. Been moved and seconded. Anybody else? Ready for the motion? All those in favor, please indicate by raising your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 7-0. Item 101, to consider proposed amendment to the traffic ordinance regarding parking on Little John Road and take any necessary action. Anybody care to have a comment, one way or the other, or care to make a motion? Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I would move the recommendations as contained in the memorandum from the town manager dated December 14th, 1994.
Second.
Do I hear a second? Is anybody else? I think it's a necessary amendment to the ordinance because I see some pictures of, and I believe the gentleman just spoke about, of the parking on both sides and what have you and how narrow the street was. So I think it's a step in the right direction, and I hope for those big events that they'll be able to find adequate parking around, maybe in the fort and walking back out. I don't know, but something's going to be done with it anyway. So we'll move on for a motion. Oh, they made it. You got it?
Motion to approve.
Yeah. All in favor? Those opposed? It's vote, 7-0. On the biggies that are coming up here, 102, 103, 104. Anybody cares to speak, I'm going to kind of open these up so you can speak on either one of them. 102 is consider accepting the offer of three local landscape architects and to assist in preparation of a preliminary plan for the purpose of Shore Road pedestrian bikeway project and take any necessary action. And 103 is to consider authorizing the soliciting of funds for a survey on Shore Road and for the cost related to the design of a bikeway on Shore Road and take any necessary action. Item 104, to consider authorizing the expenditure up to $20,000 from the undesignated surplus to complete a survey and to design a bikeway on Two Lights Road from 77 to Two Lights State Park and take any necessary action. And so what we'll do, we'll act on them individually, but if anybody wants to speak, they can speak.
Mr. Chairman?
Whichever one they want to.
Mr. Chairman, I was not aware that there was a notice of public hearing on these issues tonight, and I question holding a hearing from the audience when there was not a notice published in a public hearing.
Well, what I had decided to do, and if you councilors vote to disagree with me, I felt with so many people here, and if somebody could get up and make a quick comment one way or the other and not go over what we had in the past, that to get somebody to turn out at a meeting, I thought it would be worthwhile. But if you want to vote and disagree with me, you're welcome to it.
Well, if I had to make a motion, I would move that we go on to the items that we spent up to after midnight discussing these things once before. I can't imagine that there's a lot more to be contributed to it, and I would like to discuss the items, and I would so move that we go to the items.
Do I get a second on it?
I'll second it.
You'll second it? Seconded by Lynette. Any other comment? All in favor of the motion? Those opposed to the motion? Is defeated.
I bow to the majority.
What was that?
I said I bow to the majority.
Thank you.
With a smile.
So the manager has some opening remarks, and then I will let the public come up, and like I say, I'm going to be timing you, and I don't think there'll be too many 5-minute speeches. I might cut you off if you get going on and on of what took place at our last meeting. Thank you. Go ahead, sir.
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'll just briefly try to bring everyone up to date on what's happened since the January meeting of the Town Council. As everyone is aware, the Town Council passed two motions at the meeting in January, one involving the Shore Road bikeway and one involving a proposed bikeway on Two Lights, bikeway pedestrian shoulders. The council at that point directed that we have a meeting with the state to find out if the conditions that were adopted by the Town Council in January were acceptable to the state. We consequently did have a meeting with a number of state officials up in Augusta, and they indicated for the most part that the town's positions were acceptable. There was an issue, particularly on the Shore Road bikeway, as to whether or not a 4-foot or a 5-foot bikeway was acceptable. This was discussed later at a workshop, and I later had a phone conversation with the acting MDOT commissioner, and he confirmed in writing that on Shore Road that a 4-foot bikeway would be acceptable in areas where there would not need to be a curb, and that it would need to be 5 feet in those areas where you'd need to have a curb. That's essentially, you need the space in order to lay the curb onto some pavement to provide a good foundation for the curb. The state also indicated that if the Town Council, since the Town Council had not indicated a willingness to go ahead with construction at that point, as well as design, that it was the state's position that they would not upfront money for design, not knowing if the project was going to go ahead to completion. They did indicate that if after October 1 of this year, the town did spend any money for surveys, for design, for that type thing, and the town subsequently decided to go ahead with the project, that it would be part of the matching program within these particular grants. Following that meeting, the town council had a workshop, following a meeting with the state, and I updated the town council on what had happened at that meeting with the state that Councilor Cogswell, by the way, had also participated in. As a result of that workshop meeting, a number of local residents, three landscape architects, volunteered to develop a preliminary plan for the Shore Road pedestrian bikeway project. Their particular suggestion only included the Shore Road project, did not include two lights, and it did not include specifically the need for the survey that would first need to be done in order to develop a plan, as well as an independent cost estimate. At this point, the architects did submit a specific proposal to the town that the council members all have copies of, listing exactly what the scope of their study would be. It would become necessary to spend or raise or somehow gather about $15,000 to $16,000 for the survey and for the professional cost estimate. The suggestion has come from the volunteers that money be raised through a solicitation of funds, and that's the reason for the second item on the agenda. In an explanatory memo to the town council, it explains that no funds would be expended for either the survey, the cost estimate, or any of the other out-of-pocket expense, and no contracts would be signed until the funds were in fact raised, so we didn't get in a position of starting a project and then discovering that not enough money had been raised. Those contracts would be with the surveying firm, with the estimating firm, as well as the contract with the three architects, since we would have to have a contract with them because we would be assuming the liability for it, since they obviously wouldn't want to be personally liable, plus the firms that they work for. This would not be being done by their firms. This would be being done for the town and would be independent of their firms. The two lights bikeway, by the fact that was not included in the offer, leaves open the question as to whether or not the town would want to appropriate some funds to do that survey work and that design work. Because there's very little information on that, and you need to do both the survey and the plan, I've estimated that it would be $15,000 to $20,000. The council item number says $20,000. Even though my feeling is it's closer to 15 to 16, because lately I've had to come back to the council a few times, as you know, for additional funds, and obviously that's been an issue with this project, of whether or not it was lowballed, and I wanted to be absolutely sure that we had more than sufficient funds available to do that work. Finally, the fourth item on the agenda involves a proposed study that would take a step of looking at the entire community and seeing what the priorities are for the green belt and what issues may relate to the green belt for bikeways and what issues relate to bikeways, and similarly for sidewalks. To a lot of the issues that came out at the last public hearing indicated, well, why wasn't this looked at? Why wasn't that looked at? How come this was singled in upon? And this would give an opportunity for every citizen, regardless of their point of view, to come in and to participate in a collaborative process to help design a plan. And I've suggested to the town council that perhaps you'd like to refer that to the appointments committee or perhaps a workshop to take a look at doing that study and perhaps coming back with a recommendation to the town council. The only other really loose end on this is there was some discussion, this loose end for that may be unknown is where we stand with the state as far as they'd indicated that they'd be willing to come down and do a site inspection, which is not a formal inspection. It's really, you know, driving by very, very slowly and looking out the window and looking at the different options and coming up with a cost estimate. They have indicated that they would be coming down, if agreeable to the community, on March 6th to do that. They would be bringing with them Al Bells, who's the head of these enhancement projects, a wetlands expert, a cost estimate, and one engineer and one other person who, quite frankly, I forget who it was or what their responsibility was.
The driver.
The driver, maybe, but I think Mr. Bells indicated he would drive. But five folks, anyway, would come down on March 6th to take a look at it. So that's an overview of what the different proposals are on the council agenda, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, do you have something to add to the... I was going to open it up and see if anybody out there wanted to say a word first, and then I'll close that off, and then you can have your chat, so we don't cut anybody off. Anybody out there would care to make a comment one way or the other, to make a short statement and what have you, and I'll be timing you. Yes, Rosemary.
Thank you, Mr. Jordan. I will not be repeating any comments that I made last time, but I did... Before I spoke, I wanted to make a clarification. Isn't any member of the public in attendance at the meeting able to comment on any item that's on the agenda at any meeting?
Yes.
Thank you. I would like to just share my concerns about the items 102, 3, 4, and 5. Item 104 requests funding to be authorized for up to $20,000 in local money from undesignated surplus when the town's contribution to the whole project is estimated to be only $24,000. This, coupled with the fact that some councilors have stated publicly that they will not support expenditures on this until they have more information, my concern is this part of the two projects may be ended here tonight. In light of agenda item number 105, which has an impact on item number 104, specifically that if undesignated surplus is used to pay for number 104, consider the disadvantages of fundraising for those who have said they would solicit private funds if you in fact authorize that in item number 103. My concern, quite frankly, is for some of the volunteers and the people who have gone out on a limb saying that they will contribute both their time in fundraising and their own personal dollars for this. And I would ask that in light of the fact that some of these other agenda items have an effect on fundraising efforts, that you postpone the decision to fund Two Lights Road until an alternative, perhaps a volunteer, perhaps a group of volunteers have had time to react to the fact that the meeting with the architect suggested that this be cut loose. Many people were under the impression that when the meeting was being held, it was for both projects and bikeways in general and not Shore Road to the exclusion of Two Lights. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, the gentleman back.
My name is Alan Atkins. I live at 1189 Shore Road. I'd like to speak to item 102. As generous as the offer is, I think given the controversies associated with the Shore Road project, that it would be prudent to retain the services of an impartial architect or architects who have formed no preliminary opinions or thoughts about what should happen to Shore Road. I think at the public hearing, one of the architects expressed a very clear position as to his beliefs about Shore Road, and I think to be fair to everybody, that there should be an impartial architect hired. So I would request that the council not approve item 102.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, lady in the...
My name is Fran Haywood, 1221 Shore Road. I would like to speak specifically about the generous offer of the architects to do a design plan for the Shore Road. I have been involved in the medical profession as a professional nurse for a long time, in and out. One of the very basic ethics in the medical profession, among all competent doctors, is that when you have emotional involvement with a certain patient, if it's a family member, if it's somebody that's close to you, that you just do not get involved in important decision and important treatments. It's just so basic that human nature being what it is, that when you have emotional involvement, your judgment just cannot, absolutely cannot be objective. And I think that it doesn't mean that these architects are not very competent. It certainly doesn't mean that they're not fine and honest people. It's just not possible to have your judgment be objective when you are emotionally involved. And we know that there's been some clear stand taken by at least one and I think two of the architects. Councillor Cogshall alluded to the fact that there were some rumors circulating. I'm not familiar with that situation, but more and more you hear, and certainly there was the undercurrent in what you said, that there is some feeling on the part of at least some townspeople that some decisions have been made already prior to the public budgeting process, that I think in this town you hear more and more of an undercurrent, and it's sad actually to hear it, that there are too many not upfront kinds of dealings. We all know that there have been a lot of people in this town concerned about the genesis of this project and concerned about the ethics of the whole thing beginning to end. And I tell you that when you have lost the ability of citizens to truly trust the people that are making the decisions to make sure that they bend over backwards to get honest, objective, non-partial information on which to base very important decisions, you have lost something that's very, very important. And I urge you to think very carefully about how you handle that. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes, gentleman right here.
I'm Bob Schumann. I live at 16 Delano Park. In Councillor Linnell's motion at the last meeting, item 9 was that private property would not be taken for this project. If that's the case, and if that has any weight, I think it's improper for the council to authorize the expenditure of any money until the surveys have been made to determine where there is private property involved. Thank you.
Yes. Yes. I think I forgot you before, and I'm sorry, but to let the gentleman go ahead.
I just have one question. Maybe I missed a point last meeting. But Phyllis Cogshall referred to a survey that was made in the 1980s, I believe, and the estimate for this kind of a project was considered really prohibitive, all things considered, and an estimate was made for, I believe, $800,000. And what has invalidated that survey? Why can't we move on that survey and just move from there, which would eliminate any more discussion, I would think.
Yeah. I might answer that one. There have been 3 or 4 studies done of this project. An early one back in the early 80s of a Shore Road bikeway study was done by COG. Quite frankly, I don't remember what the estimate was on that one. There was a second study done of a Shore Road bikeway by T.Y. Lynn International in the, I believe, the late 1980s. That showed a price, a cost estimate, my recollection is, between in the high 500s. A wider bikeway of about 8 feet might have been up, you know, in $700,000-$800,000, but I don't never heard anyone suggesting that a bikeway of that width ought to be done. There was a third study done by DeLuca Hoffman that indicated a construction cost estimate of Shore Road for a 4-foot bikeway, which is the or shoulder improvement, which is what's being discussed here, for $300,000 was that estimate, which equates with the construction cost that's proposed in this project.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
My name is Fred Joshua from McKinney Point Road, and I wanted to comment on item number 104. My concern is similar to Rosemary's in the sense that I'd like not to see that particular project killed at this time. I think there are some alternatives on that particular project. From my point of view, the most dangerous portion of that road is from Pheasanton to the entrance to the state park, and there's a rise in the road that is difficult to see over. Beyond that, from Pheasanton on to the 77 is pretty clear sailing for the most part. And so I'd like to, if the $20,000 turns out to be too expensive, the town council doesn't want to spend that much, I'd like to at least consider doing from Pheasanton to the park entrance, and I think that would be a dramatic improvement to the safety of that road. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Yes.
I'm John Knight, 21 Broad Cove Road, and having been trained under the auspices of the former chairman of Fast Gavel Chapel, I appreciate the opportunity to be able to speak. One of the things that bothered me about reporting of the open meeting last time was the fact that many people, more people here were speaking for this project than were against it. I didn't rise at the time opposing it because the reasons that I had for opposing it had been spoken to by other people before that. So I just wanted to let you know that if you're counting again, I'm again it.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I'll get you, John.
Gentleman in the back. Yeah.
Hi, my name is Richard Berman. I live at 1021 Shore Road, and I sent a letter to the town manager and to all of the councilors. And I just wanted to say that I favor improvements along Shore Road. Of course, I'm not sure at what cost and what that means to diversity in the town and things like that. I don't want old people to have to move out of the town for me to have a bikeway, walkway. But I think, I'm talking to, I guess it's item, the offer of the landscape architects. I think it's great that they're willing to put in service for the town. But I also believe that the council needs to direct, if you choose to use these designers, to direct them in their efforts. My concern, as you know, is that it seems to be predisposed that we're going to do 4-foot shoulder widenings. That concerns me very much because from the town hearing, what I heard and what I feel, too, is that we need a pathway mainly for kids to use their bikes to go to school. We heard a lot about that, and the casual bicyclists and pedestrians and joggers. I live on the road. I see what people use it. What we really need is a multi-use path. I think if you directed the designers just to look at the cost of doing and what you have to do to widen the Shore Road on 4 feet on either side, that would be a terrible mistake. I think I won't go over all the details unless you'd like me to, but I did consult traffic engineers. We did look at that scenario. And if that were done, it would only be suitable for what's called experienced bicyclists. Experienced bicyclists wear spandex suits and they go real fast, and they don't mind being on the road. They also only make up 5% of the bicycling population. What we really need is a multi-use path for kids and for parents, for joggers, for pedestrians, for that type of use. And I think the other thing the council has to be aware of is there have been court cases where there have been inadequate designs built where kids have gotten into accidents and the town has been sued because they've created, I don't know what the legal term is, but something like an attractive nuisance, something that gets kids out there, but it isn't safe for kids. And there are standards. I included some of those in your packages. There are standards that really, you know, would open up a lot of liability. And so I urge the council to sort of accept this offer, I suppose, with a directive to come up with a design that is suitable for the people that that this is supposed to serve. Again, I went through a long letter here I sent to you, and I don't mean to take up any time with that. I hope you all understood it. But it really needs some looking at it. We would absolutely be a mistake to just widen the shoulders on Shore Road. And
thank you. Yes, you want to comment?
Yeah, just a quick question, Mr. Berman. I read your letter, and when you talked about a multi-purpose path, are you talking about a multi-purpose path on the shoulder of Shore Road or somewhere else?
Well, I think the designers could come up with alternatives, but to serve the population that I heard at the public hearing, what I see out there, the only design that probably would work, and it might cost more money, and that's an issue, and we have to look at it. But I'd rather build something that works than something that doesn't. But what would work for multi-thing is a separated path from the road. Would have to it might be a separation of 4 feet. It might be a separation of bollards in some places where it has to come close to the road. From where I live, which is right at the back end of Fort Williams, the back entrance there, all the way up to Pond Cove, there's only two houses. There's a lot on the west side of the road. It might be that people might donate easements or right-of-ways or even land for this to go, you know, not next to the road, but separated. That's the only safe thing. And if you look at all the standards for kids on bicyclists, it says kids on bicycles shouldn't be on the road. It stands to reason. If you're using a public road, you should have a driver's license. And they break that down. And the people that they consider children bicyclists are 15 and under. And that's what I heard a lot about.
Okay. Well, one of my, you know, a couple of my concerns with that is...
You got something that's going to go on, or you got something that can be answered quick?
Just food for thought.
Okay.
I just want to respond. You were put a lot of effort into writing your letter, so
yeah, I did.
Wanted to give you an opportunity to just to hear my remarks and perhaps just food for thought. A lot of the issues people brought up were concerns about private property and safety and security. And it seems to me that if you put a path off in the woods somewhere, you still have some security issues. It may well be more expensive, and it may be talking about private property.
I think
what I just wanted to say, this is something that if it goes through that way, the volunteers that are going to survey and come in with ideas and what have you. So
okay.
I just don't.
I know that John Mitchell designed a great pathway system for South Portland, and that was a multi-use separated system. And yes, it might cost more, but if we can't afford it, we shouldn't do anything. That's my
whole point. Do it right or do nothing, huh?
Yeah, do it right or do nothing. Don't open up the town of liability and don't create a white elephant.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Gentleman in the red sweater there.
Mr. Chairman, I'm John Chapman, 77 Hillcrest Road. You know, I've worked at every level of government over the last 17 years. And I've got to say, I'm not sure I've ever seen a better example of public spiritedness than the proposal that these three architects are making. This is the type of thing that makes government work. And I think the council would be making a mistake in rejecting it. Let me also say that it seems to me that you ought to find that this argument that these three people are not the appropriate people to do this because they're somehow emotionally committed to this is unpersuasive. I've seen no evidence that they are emotionally attached to this. It seems to me only natural that an architect is going to make some preliminary judgment about whether a project can go forward before that architect designs a plan. It seems to me that that's all that these three have done, is made that preliminary determination, perhaps, in their mind. There's no evidence, and there's no reason, I think, that you ought to find that they're somehow improperly emotionally committed to this. Thank you.
Thank you. What I just want to say is that 105 is appointing a committee to, and they'll be working with these architects and what have you, and we're going to make sure there's some on both sides of the issue heavily. Anybody else? Gentleman way back in the corner, you know.
My name's Steve Barber, and I live at Two Lights Road. And I did speak last time, but I won't say the same things that I said last time. And I guess I was here last time and got to see the, it was a much bigger crowd and much more lively crowd than we have today. But I think one of the things that everybody really wanted about the last meeting is let's get both the issues on the table and let's see what comes out. Let's get the study done. And I just seen, or I got a call last night regarding the breakup of these two issues. And what I'd like to see is both the issues go to be studied. I think it's a great offer that the architects made, and I don't know why they didn't do Two Lights Road and why they're just doing Shore Road. And what my thoughts would be great. You know, you've got a great deal on one. You got to pay some money for the other one, average your costs, and you got a great deal on both of them. But to leave one out, I think we're letting the architects decide, you know, what the outcomes are going to be, and I think that's just real, real special interest. The other point I'd like to make is people say that Two Lights isn't dangerous, all right? And we've had some situations happen there that have been horrible. I know my kids and I walk up to the corner at that little store just about every Saturday and Sunday, and it's a dangerous road, point blank, it is. And I am a guy that walks on that road with my kids. And so I don't understand how all of a sudden Two Lights Road isn't dangerous, and Cape or in Shore Road is real dangerous. And I don't understand from the meeting I was at a few weeks ago, we were talking about let's look at both the issues and study both the issues, and now it's, well, let's look at Shore Road. And maybe my perception's a little bit wrong, and maybe the person's perception that called me is wrong that asked me to come and say something tonight. But I think you should consider that and in making your decision. So thank you.
Thank you. Gentleman right here.
Mr. Chairman, I'm Fred Poole, and I live at 58 Two Lights Road. And I want to speak specifically about item number 104, which is the one that involves Two Lights. I've been up here before, and I followed this process pretty much from the start, I believe. And it's my first experience with following town government, and I have to say that I've been amazed by a lot of the things that I've heard and a lot of the process that I've observed and fascinated by. not the least of what amazes me is the fact that we continue to mix together two issues that I believe are quite different, that of the bike path on Shore Road and that of the bike path on Two Lights Road. And they've been mixed together in the past, and they continue to be mixed together tonight in the comment. And I would like to try to specifically address the item number 104. Now, it's clear to me that, practically speaking, we have a situation where half the council members have decided that they're for bike paths, and half appear to have decided that they're against bike paths, and we have somebody caught halfway in the middle there. And we have the situation of somebody in this town a couple of years ago having thought that these projects were sufficiently worthy to submit some sort of request to the state that we be considered for funding for these projects. They must have had to provide the state with some sort of information about how long these roads are, what the properties are like around them. The state must have somehow come up with these numbers that they came up with as to how much it would cost to build a bike path and how much it would cost to do a survey. And yet we have, by the process that we're doing this, the council members appear, and I don't blame them, to have so little trust in this process that we now find it necessary to come up with other means to solicit volunteers, to solicit public contributions, to ascertain by some other kind of survey, number one, how much property, how much rural character we're going to affect, and how much money it's going to cost. And I don't blame certain councilors for being concerned about the answers to those questions. And this fascinates me that we're now in the position of having to ask the councilors to vote to spend $15,000 or $20,000 more of the town money to decide whether to accept the money that we're being given on the basis of a project that we proposed, the alternative to which might be to turn down all of that money and to turn down the project. Now, I would like very much if the council decided to vote in favor of 104 tonight. But if they can't, because it now represents the prospect of coming up with another $15,000 or $20,000 of town money, I would very much like to suggest as the alternative that they at least table the issue of the bike path on Two Lights Road until a little bit more time can be used to answer the questions that certain councilors rightfully have about the nature of the impact of such a thing and how much it would cost. And that we don't just dismiss it out of hand after all the time and effort that's been put into it.
Thank you. I just want to say that we didn't solicit for those people to volunteer. They come forward with us with the idea that they would do the office work and the study as far as the council. To my knowledge, I didn't, and I don't think any councilor did, go after them to volunteer it. They've done that on their own and come forward with it, and I just wanted to get that straight.
Well, I understand that. I agree with you, but I believe that they came forth partly in response to the prospect that the project might be turned down.
Well, that may
be true. If the design money were not granted from the state without the contingency that the project would go ahead, which was the way the last meeting left the decision on the matter.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else? We're going to take one or two more and then we'll cut it. Lady in back.
My name is Cheryl Dubler, and I'm at 989 Shore Road, and I want to address the issue of the bike path on Shore Road. Where I live, it doesn't really affect me one way or the other, but my feelings are it is not a safe operation to have a bike path within 4 or 5 feet of that road. The alternative pathway that the gentleman in fact mentioned, I think, would be the safest, and I would be for that, because then I think that there would be it would be much safer and it would be a much better alternative because it gets the people off of the road. Because that road has a 35-mile-an-hour speed limit, but I very rarely see anyone operating on 35 miles an hour around those curves. I think we're all aware of that very much, but that's what I just want to go on record on the feelings of that.
Thank you. Somebody had the hand up down here on the right. Yes, John.
John Mitchell, Smugglers Cove Road. I would like, there have been a couple things that have been mentioned this evening that I would like to just clarify. The first is what is being proposed by the three landscape architects is only a study. And I want to emphasize that it's what the title of this proposal reads. It's a pedestrian bikeway impact assessment study. It's only to determine the impact or to assess the feasibility of road widening on Shore Road. It is not, we do not intend to design this to any great detail. We do also intend to, as we mentioned in the outline, propose to work very closely with a steering committee or a design review committee. We do not intend to just go away and design this and come back to you. We do propose to answer to a committee. And we mentioned all of the contacts that we would propose to have throughout this study. Also, just a point of clarification, the cost of this, as we indicated, is 10 to 12, not 15 to 16. And the last thing I'd like to mention is I understand that through the town manager's memo, there's a recommendation to table this item, whatever it is, 102 and 103. I would like to say that by tabling this would delay the fundraising portion of this project. And there are a lot of people that are eager to start or organize the fundraising of this project. We cannot begin the surveying portion of this project until we receive the funds. The ideal time to do a survey of this type is as soon as the snow melts and before the leaves appear, and also before the traffic volumes occur out there on Shore Road. There is a cost savings that can be realized if we hit that window of time. And we would, since we are fundraising, every dollar counts, and we would like to take advantage of that window of time. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Yes.
Alice Rand, and I live beside Shore Road, 1222. Pretty soon, I fear I might live on Shore Road. I do agree with Mr. Dalbach that I really am up here under duress. I didn't want to come and speak, but I fear that this is turning into kind of a public hearing again, and I really feel that we should have made it known that if anybody wanted to speak on this issue, which is very controversial, that it should have been more publicized. But aside from that, I would like you to think about the concept that perhaps there is a premise which is being put forward that a widening of Shore Road or Tulies Road would assure us of more safety. And I think that it might behoove us, if we are concerned with this as being an issue, that we call upon officials in public safety to give us some data about that. And I think that that is certainly a very large side issue associated with this. Thank you very much.
Thank you. One more. Gentleman down.
My name is Richard Mahoney, 27 Fowler Road. I would just like a little education for myself from all of you on this issue and other issues similar to this. When information is gathered on this issue, and sound information, will each citizen of Cape Elizabeth of voting age get an opportunity to express their feeling on this?
Yes.
They will. It's not simply determined by all of the councillors after fact gathering has taken place. Will it be a referendum? Will it be a public issue?
I wouldn't say it'd be a referendum, but I think at an issue like this, and once the survey is done, for people to understand, I should think that the council would agree to some public hearing of some sort and get people's opinion whether they agree that tree shouldn't go and that tree might stay and things like that.
In other words, a pro and con list of facts will be available from the
surveys are done, yes.
Thank you.
I would think so. Now, maybe the rest of the council disagree with me, but which they do quite often. Okay. Yes, you want to comment?
Sure. I mean, there would be a committee of, I think, seven people, which would not be the council, which would work on this design and I would certainly, they would be encouraged, the public would be welcome to any of their, to their meetings, and to have some input into what they do.
Okay.
But after everything is said and done, does the public have the final decision?
No.
No. It's up to the council.
You have a decision on your list.
Thank you.
Okay. I said I was going to cut it off after the last one, but I see one more hand down there, and I recognize the gentleman, and I think you had a tremendous article in the Cape Courier, because I've got a few telephone calls stating what a wonderful job you've done. Now, how can you add to that? And I'll give you 1 minute.
I'm Frank Potenzo, Ivy Road. I hope all of you have read the article. It was a labor of love, believe me. It seems like we're picking Shore Road apart piece by piece, and we're missing the point. Well, now we're getting architects that are going to give free time. All of a sudden, it's $12,000 to $15,000 they have to raise. One of the gentlemen that spoke earlier, the way I interpreted some of the things he said is we're putting the cart before the horse. Now, if you're going to have a survey, and it's a voluntary survey plus 7 other volunteers from the town, go ahead with the survey, but I don't see expending any money for the Article 102 or expending another $20,000 for Item 104. How many surveys do we have to have? It's like having a referendum that fails, and in a couple of years, the proponents come back with the referendum up again. It fails. They wait a couple of years. They come back with it again, hoping that the thinking of people changes. We can't do that. We can't keep having issues like this come up that people are taking sides. And the basic thing is that, in my estimation, a lot of people I've talked to, is that Shore Road does not lend itself to be widened. It's just not wide enough to begin with. And you consider 4 or 5 feet bike path plus another 4 feet for shoulders and grading. And this other idea of a special path through the woods, that's taking private property. I don't think there are many people in Cape Elizabeth that would like to give up their private property to have a path going in and around their homes. And secondly, or thirdly, I guess, I don't know of any kids in the northern part of Cape Elizabeth that bicycle to school. And if the road is considered dangerous to travel because of so many curves, I think it would be 1,000 times more dangerous if it were widened. And a lot of people I talked to said they don't allow their kids to take bicycles on Shore Road. If it's widened, I doubt that that would ever happen. One last thing, and I indulge you. Today's paper, a big article about widening roads, the main turnpike and everything. One thing struck me, and it said that we all pay taxes because we buy gasoline. The tax money goes into a highway fund. The bigger obstacle than the money crunch may be getting people out of their cars. But it says Americans like the convenience of driving. A big chunk of their culture, independence and self-esteem is tied in with owning an automobile. And Maine is even more dependent on cars because of its rural, far-flung state with a dispersed population. Experience shows it's hard to get people to use alternate modes of transportation even in the state's most urbanized region. So I don't think people are going to give up their cars and buy bicycles and to go to Pond Cove or any place in Cape. There are other areas recreational biking can take place, and jogging too. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Okay, I guess we'll close the public part of it there and move on to item 102. And I want to thank all the people that wrote me letters and sent me notes and called me on the phone. We had a $10-11 million school, and I had more calls and what have you on this than I did the school. So I it isn't a money issue. I guess it, in this day and age, I guess it's what's happened to the maybe I should say the landscaping of a community is the best
Mr. Chairman?
Way of putting it. Yes, I was
Sorry.
Going to move on to 102 and take them with us. Do you have a comment as a whole, or
no, no,
you want to comment on them?
I had a motion.
You had a motion, but I was going to read the article again. You're satisfied with it? Go ahead, shoot.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the offer from the three local landscape architects to assist in the preparation of the preliminary plan for the proposed Shore Road pedestrian bikeway project.
Do I hear a second on it?
Second.
And moved in second. Do I have a, anybody have a comment? Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I really want to make more of a global comment, which I think may be in keeping with the fact that you opened some public comment this evening on more than one item, and I beg the council's indulgence, but I want to tie the whole process together, which I think is something we really need to do. We've had a lot of divisiveness so far, and I think the fact that we may be able to tie things back together and start getting back, probably going through a bit of a healing process, which I think is becoming quite necessary. I'm also going to support later this evening the item to establish a community planning process for the broader picture of bikeways, pedestrian pathways, sidewalks, green belt. And I think that will be a very good constructive process. This council was generous enough to fund my participation in a learning institute this year. I've gone through 14 of the 15 sessions of that institute. The underlying principle of that institute is coming to civic leadership through collaborative processes. And I wanted to share with you the collaborative premise that that institute is based upon. I believe the planning process that we will be discussing later this evening is also based upon this premise. And that is, if you bring the appropriate people together, which we would certainly try to do through most likely the appointments committee process, if you bring the appropriate people together in constructive ways, a constructive way certainly would be something different than we've seen so far. It would be people working together and getting all views aired equally. In constructive ways with good information. That is the crux of the item that's before us right now, item 102, in my mind. I've heard a number of councillors besides myself saying they want some better information before they make a final decision about the status of the shoulder improvements. We do not have that information in hand as yet. Forming this committee will not give us that information. That information needs to be done by people like the three landscape architects who have stepped forward to this point. We need topographical survey information. We do not have that yet. We need to get the information. If you bring the appropriate people together in constructive ways with good information, they will come up with authentic visions and strategies for their organizations and communities. Although the council does have the final decision, if it is what the people have come to consensus on, then this would be an instance of good leaders following. The good leaders in that case being the council. I seconded the motion because I think we have been presented with a very unique opportunity to obtain the good information that we need. We're not going to get it any other way. You've got to find the design. You've got to go through the design process to get the information. What has been proposed by these three gentlemen can be part of the process, part of the collaborative process, and can be done concurrently with that citizen committee that goes through the planning process. In fact, we might even want to get to the point where we consider, in the next item,
funding some of what we would hopefully approve these gentlemen to do. The manager had come up with an estimate of $10,000 for that committee. Stay with me, Councilor Chapel, to be formed.
Smile.
I'm waiting to get done.
I appreciate that. If we go ahead with a request for PACS funding, and if we get a citizen facilitator, that $10,000 can be lessened considerably. I don't think it would be inappropriate for us to consider putting $5,000 of town funds into the project for the survey information that we need for Shore Road. There's been a question about fundraising. These gentlemen did not have to come to this council with their proposal. They could have done it on their own, and I think everybody needs to realize that, but they have chosen to try to work through the process of this governmental body. The fundraising that they're proposing gives them the tax-deductible status that other organizations such as the Land Trust have. I have heard their professional integrity questioned this evening. I want to say that I have had professional relationships with all three of these gentlemen. I have worked for two of them. I know them from that side, and I have reviewed their work in my professional capacity in another community. Yes, landscape architects sometimes show passion. That does not mean they're not going to do an objective presentation. And I think we would be really remiss if we did not accept their offer this evening. Again, I think it's a very unique offer, and I think it will fit in very, very well with what I foresee, anyway, is a very strong, collaborative, and constructive process for this community. Thank you.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes. Councilor Nell.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. I think we need the information that these architects are willing to provide. I mean, it's pretty hard to, I know there's been some resistance on the part of a lot of people to, or on the project, and there's been a lot of mythical figures thrown out about it's going to be 10 feet on each side. I've heard 16 feet. I think when they, if we allow them to go forward with this design preliminary study, they can answer those questions, say which tree, which stone wall would be moved, if at all. There's little or no risk to the town by what they do, or what they would do. It would be incumbent upon those three architects to work with the committee which we authorized at the last town meeting. It's incumbent on them to work with them and to come up with a design that would be acceptable to other people in town. These are not Martians that would be doing the study. I mean, these are people from Cape Elizabeth. I think they care as much about this town as anyone else here. They care enough about Shore Road that they not only want to drive it, they want to be able to walk down it. We've talked about safety, and just bear with me a second. I want to make sure that people, you know, we've talked, a lot of discussion has gone back and forth about safety. It's been used to justify both sides of the argument. And one thing that hasn't been discussed at length was the fact that the DOT has identified one link, or one section of Cape Elizabeth, which is over their 1.0 critical rate factor threshold, and that's Shore Road. So I think it there may be some other benefits from these architects looking at the road. There may be some benefits as far as site distances and so forth that could be improved just a little bit. And I think we'll be ahead of the game if we let them go ahead. I don't think we should stand in their way.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes, sir.
May I? I can't vote for that motion that Councilor Nonell just went through, and I'd like to give you the reasons, if I may. I started out, I think, probably that I was one of the ones that approved a design for these roads. I figured we needed it. I didn't have too much to go on until that time. When you talk about the architects, I've worked with John Mitchell. I worked with Tom Emery. I had John with me on the Town Center Planning Committee. I had Tom Emery with me on the Facilities Management Committee. You couldn't ask for two finer men, in my estimation. Their offer for what they're going to do for the town, there's no question about it being a number one. But in that motion that we approved on 1-9, we said that they would approve design and no work till October 95. We got to go back and rescind that if we're going to do anything tonight. If we don't rescind that vote that's already on the books, we've got to make the same language in this, no work till October 95. I don't think you can take a previous vote and just knock it out. I do appreciate the three volunteers, as I said, and they should be members of a larger committee. I think we're forgetting that Cape Elizabeth has traditionally done things through committee work, and I've been for this since we started. This process gives us exceptional results. We get the pros, anti-pros, cons, whatever you want to call them, and we sit down and talk about this thing, and not in the heat of a little bit of an argument like we get into here, and I understand that. And I think it's healthy. I think we've done well. Look at the example of committee work. Main Street 90, Facilities Management Committee, built the highway garage as a result of that, and have plans for bays and work for the fire department and the police department to use 5 years, 10 years, whenever we can get to it. Work's been done. Wonderful. Town Center. John worked with that. All volunteer at that time, too. Look at your town center plan. It's operating. It's coming. We have a committee rewriting zoning for the town center, all done by committee. And then the new one that we have, the ZORC committee, I love that one, Zoning Ordinance Rewrite Committee. Phyllis Coggeshall is the chairperson of that. We call him Madam ZORC. And my question of this is, let's do this again. Let's take number, they use these things out of order. I don't think these were put in there in order the way they should have been if you're going to vote intelligently anyway. Let's take 105 and let's approve it as far as I'm concerned, getting the appointment committee going and getting these committees together and getting gentlemen and ladies from both sides on it. Boy, what a difference that'll make. And they sit down and they all talk together and then they come back with a plan. We haven't got a plan right now. We haven't got a darn thing. And I would like, if I had the motion, I can't change the one that's already on there, but I would table 102, 103, and 104, and I would unanimously approve 105, and I would extend an invitation right now to those gentlemen to head to be on that committee with other members that we're going to have from the Cape Elizabeth. I think this will work. We have a problem, but that is my way of solving it, is through the committee. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor McLaughlin.
A couple of questions, Councilor Chappell. I'm looking at the minutes from the meeting of January 9, and what I see is no design work may occur until October 1995. I quite distinctly heard John Mitchell tonight say they were not going to do design work. They were going to do a feasibility study. That's different. So I don't see that it's in conflict with the vote that we made last month. I'm also wondering where you think the money for the survey work would come from if we just included these three gentlemen in the citizen committee. There needs to be some information gathered through topographical survey before they can do their feasibility study. Where do you think that money, where do you propose for that money to come from?
If you're I'd leave that up to the town manager and the committee that's appointed. They can request from him what they need and then we'll have a vote on it.
Rather than them doing fundraising?
I don't like at all.
So you think that the town, that the council may approve the $10,000 to $12,000 just for the survey work?
The council may approve what, Counselor?
Mr. Mitchell this evening said it was $10,000 to $12,000 for the survey work and the cost estimate. Is that something you're going to be willing to approve for that committee to have for working money?
No.
For that component? Then where are we going to get the how are we going to get the information? I don't understand where you think the information, how it's going to be developed.
I would very simply wait till that committee is formed and meet the first time and find out what they need to work with and bring it back to the council, and we'd have something to start with, not just a figure of I suppose.
Counselor Dahlbeck.
Just to get out of the crossfire for a moment. I think we have here a great example of what happens when one brings a complex and controversial type of issue to council without even having a workshop on it. I mean, this just sort of popped in on us, and we've been in the middle of the battle ever since. Sometimes without knowing completely what we're talking about. Now, maybe there was a workshop. I've only been here 3 years, 6 or 8 or 10 years ago. I don't know that, but I think there's a lot to be discussed. I personally would also like to see the results of the MDOT people coming and doing their drive-through. All of this started on an offer made from Augusta, I guess, and Washington. And sometimes some of the proposals bear absolutely no resemblance to the offer, or seem to me not to bear resemblance to the offer that was made and on which the funding is based. And it'd be very helpful for me to know what the view is of the MDOT people as far as the feasibility goes. And I think we're still dealing with a half a deck. And I would agree, I like maybe for somewhat different reasons, to have items 1, 2, 3, and 4 tabled.
Thank you. Anybody else? No? Councilor Nell.
I think Councilor McLaughlin made a good point about the feasibility study. It seems to me that's what they're asking for, is a feasibility study. But just for the sake of argument, I don't think we should split hairs on whether or not the previous last council meeting's motion talked about the design work, because we have had design work on this issue. We've got the DeLuca Hoffman study, we've got the T.Y. Lynn study, so certainly design work has already occurred before 1995. I think I don't I have a lot of confidence in what these architects would do. They will study this, give us some more information, won't cost us anything. I think I don't know as we need to wait put them on hold until the DOT comes, because goodness knows when the DOT is coming by. I thought they'd be here by now, actually. And all the DOT is going to do is a drive-by. So I think they could, we should let them get going on their fundraising and some of their preliminary feasibility studies.
Thank you. Councilor Marvin.
The way the motion is on the floor right now, I'll just speak to that one issue now, although there's, I have a lot more to say about all this. As far as item 102 is concerned, the problem we have right now is that three local landscape architects were kind enough to come forward and offer their services to our community. And I think they did so in the very best spirits. They genuinely felt that they could offer a professional opinion that could be helpful to all of us. The regretful part about this is that at least two of them have been publicly identified as people who are strong proponents of the project. And what that means is that there are people in this community who, no matter what, will, after the study is done, say, this was bad public policy. This was not the way this should have gone out. The problem is that they'll always think that the results were tainted. And Councilor McLaughlin was nice enough to tell us about the collaborative process. If you bring the appropriate people together, the appropriate people, and I'm not sure that these are the appropriate people. And unfortunately, I know all three of these people, and I think that they do a marvelous job, but because of the way events have rolled out, I really think we'd be making a terrible mistake to accept their offer, and therefore I will vote against item 102.
Thank you. Councilor Dalbach.
Having been duly coached a bit by a couple of my fellow councilors who are behind me all the way, I guess, I would like to move that we table items number 102, and I gather I can, that's a valid motion, items number 102 to 104.
I'll second.
Yeah. Can you table that before we vote on the
yes.
previous motion?
Yes.
Motion to table will take out. Is that correct? You're the expert. Is that correct?
Motions to table supersede.
Yeah. You want to send a motion? All in favor of the tabling, please indicate by raising your right hand. Those opposed, it's a vote, 4-3. You get who did what? Okay. So we'll move on to 103.
We
just voted on 102.
Just table 2, 3, and 4.
Oh, I didn't understand it that way.
Don't change your vote.
Yeah. I understood, and I thought you said 102 and 104.
He said 102, 3, and 4.
Huh? Is that the way you got it down? Okay. I'll accept. I don't know why I shouldn't, but... So the vote was 4-3. Oh, you all don't have a paper down here.
Do you have the clerk read it?
What'd you say?
Why don't you have the clerk read it? Have Debbie read it.
You got it in front of you? The motion.
The motion.
The motion was to table items number 102, 103, and 104. That will pass 4-3.
Do you want to read the motions? Okay.
Yeah. Item number 102 is to consider accepting an offer from three local landscape architects to assist in the preparation of a preliminary plan for the proposed Shore Road pedestrian bikeway project. Item number 103 was to consider authorizing the solicitation of funds for a survey of Shore Road and for other costs related to the design of a bikeway on Shore Road. Item number 104 was to consider authorizing the expenditure up to $20,000 from undesignated surplus to complete a survey and to design a bikeway on Two Lights Road from Route 77 to Two Lights State Park. Those did pass 4 yeas, 3 nays. Councilors McLaughlin, Marvin, and Linnell opposed.
Okay.
Oh, wait a minute.
That's right. Table.
It's to table.
It's to table.
You table an item before the motion?
What was that?
You table an item before somebody has made a motion on it?
Yeah, was the motion.
The motion was to table it.
The motion was to table.
Who made the motion? Who seconded it?
Councilor Dalbach motion made the motion. Councilor Cogswell seconded.
What happened to the first motion?
The table and over. Okay. Item 105, consider referring to the Appointments Committee a proposal to undertake a community planning study to update the Greenbelt plan and to look at bicycles and sidewalk issues and take any necessary action.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes.
I make a motion we accept item number 105 as written.
I second that.
Moved and seconded. Any council comment one way or the other? Councilor Cogswell.
Perhaps Mr. McGovern would explain this to us.
since we as a body have not really discussed the actual composition of this group and the mission we want to give them, I've perhaps you could go over it for us now and also explain what a P2 steering committee is. This is draft on top.
Yes, be happy to. P2 is pedals and pedestrians plan.
Oh.
I really do appreciate the assistance of the town planner in drafting this. What this provides for is the development of an extensive public participation process to look at the need for bike lanes, sidewalks, and greenbelt trails in the town. It indicates the catalyst for it is the availability of grant monies to construct paved shoulders on Shore Road and Two Lights Road. A townwide evaluation of bicyclists and pedestrian facility needs is designed to allocate infrastructure expenditures consistent with community standards. Project-specific recommendations and possible project oversight would be developed in an interactive public forum. It is expected that any final plan would position the town to successfully compete for future grants that come up in the two-year cycle through MDOT or through other sources. The council would appoint a pedals and pedestrian steering committee to guide public development of the plan. The steering committee would focus its efforts in facilitating meaningful public participation and the evolution of the plan. The final draft plan would come to the town council, and you would consider adoption of the plan as a component of the comprehensive plan only after review of and revisions to the plan as necessary. Any final adopted plan would be considered through our annual capital improvements process as the funding. The committee would also be asked to comment on projects currently under consideration by the council, such as the Shore Road shoulders, the Two Light shoulders, and town center sidewalks. The committee would consist of 9 members who were appointed by the council, including 2 council members, a representative of the planning board, 1 from the Conservation Commission, and 5 members from the public. They could have subcommittees as they desired, and any subcommittee would be chaired by a member of the full committee, and the subcommittees would report back to the full committee. There'd be a status report to the council by the end of this calendar year, a final draft of a plan by May 30, 1996, and again, it emphasized the committee would be charged with encouraging exhaustive public interaction. And it's expected that through that process, there would be perhaps public support for their plan. There would be, do you want me to continue going through this?
Sure.
Okay. The components of the plan would be a strategy for meaningful public participation and input at every stage, an inventory of existing greenbelt and other commonly used trails, sidewalks, bike lanes, and significant utility easements in the town, an inventory of existing and proposed greenbelt, sidewalk, and bike lane connections to Cape from South Portland and Scarborough. Criteria for the location of new facilities. Objective criteria shall be approved by the steering committee with public input and before a new facility shall be considered. In establishing criteria, the steering committee may wish to consider pedestrian and cyclist safety, visual impacts, proximity to existing facilities, population concentrations, and popular destinations. Recommended locations for upgraded trails, sidewalks, bike lanes in order of priority. Estimated cost of each facility split into land acquisition, if applicable, construction costs. Maps of existing facilities and proposed facilities should be prepared for public review and inclusion in the plan. And an appendix which would provide standard construction details for greenbelt trails, sidewalks, and bike lanes. The details may be copied from existing sources with the notation that site-specific alterations may be needed. There'd be a consultant retained whose primary responsibility would be create and implement a public participation plan and the development of the plan. The planning staff would also work with the steering committee, that would mean Maureen, and would attend all meetings, help to actually prepare the plan, to coordinate mapping associated with the project. Reference materials to be made available would include the comprehensive plan, the greenbelt plan, the visual assessment study, MDOT and Police Department accident traffic count data, the Shore Road Bikeway studies, and the regional bike and pedestrian plan. The budget would be approximately $10,000 to be used for any consultants that may be mapping and printing costs, and the project would be completed in May of 96. And this, part of the reason for that date is that MDOT had indicated to the town council that they didn't, to the town, that there didn't need to be a final decision on the Two Lights bikeway or the Shore Road bikeway from the town until September of 96. So if those were still deemed to be a priority as this project evolved, the town council would still have an opportunity to move forward with them.
Okay, Councilor Cogdell.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. I guess my main concern is if we vote for this as presented tonight, are we also authorizing a $10,000 expenditure, or is that going to come up in the budget process?
It would be, you know, unless you specifically voted to appropriate it this evening, I would see this as a clear direction that you'd want to see $10,000 or thereabouts in the budget in order to accomplish what this study entails. It cannot be done for no money. There will be some expense.
But I do question having a consultant or a facilitator, as was mentioned before. I think we can have volunteers who will be able to do that for no additional cost. So if we vote for this as presented, you're saying that it would be a consideration in the budget process of this $10,000, but we are not officially authorizing it tonight. What we're doing is sending it to the appointments committee to discuss and advertise for volunteers for the committee.
If that was a question, I'm not sure, because I'm not sure if the motion was to accept this as proposed.
It was.
Whether or not it was what was referred to under item number 105, which was referred to the appointments committee, or whether or not it was to accept this as drafted. I was left unsure of that.
I believe the motion read the item, and that's a referral. It's not approving this evening. And what I would see is having the appointments committee have a workshop with the full council to get input from everybody, and then the appointments committee, I'll speak for them, could draft up the final language that would be presented probably next month at the council meeting for a formal vote. And then if it was decided to go ahead, the appointments committee would advertise and do interviews and have recommendations for the council either in April or May for the committee composition.
Okay.
Anybody else?
I just need clarification.
Yes, so, Councilor Marvin.
We are authorizing the $10,000 tonight, or we're not?
No.
We are.
This is being referred to appointments committee, and I would say as chair of the appointments committee, we would not take definitive action until we had workshop input from the rest of the council.
Good.
Just
go ahead.
One other clarification, and it's my assumption, unless I hear to the contrary, that you would like me, if there were grant sources for this project with very little strings,